Hi everyone, welcome back to my YouTube videos. In this video, I'm going to give you an overview of the main concept we saw in this playlist about discrete-time Markov chain. So you notice that the theory of discrete-time Markov chain is very dense. We saw a lot of different concepts, a lot of different definitions, and we saw also a lot of results that connect those concepts together, but everything I did so far were basically independent pieces of the theory, illustrated by examples of application. What I'm going to do instead in this video is put together all those pieces, and I'm going also to give you some kind of checklist with the main tricks and recipes that you need to know to study a discrete-time Markov chain. And everything I'm going to talk about is in fact based on this diagram that is part of my stochastic modeling book, that's in chapter 7 of my stochastic modeling book. But for this video, I modified this diagram, I updated this diagram and improved it, and now we are going to work with this diagram instead. So you see that this picture looks like a big directed graph, where in fact each path is going to tell you the steps you need to follow to answer specific questions. So instead of explaining this diagram all at once, that looks a little bit overwhelming, I'm going to give you a list of the main questions we can ask about a discrete-time Markov chain. And then we are going to use this diagram to see which path we need to follow to answer each of those questions. So going back to my previous videos with all the examples of applications, you will see that in fact there are four main questions about a discrete-time Markov chain. I'm going to list those questions here. So the first one is the following. So let's assume that we have two states X and Y like this. First question can be, if we are in state X, what is the probability that N time steps after will be in state Y? So for instance, I can draw a picture like that. So maybe we jump like this, like this, like this. And so question is, if we are in state X today, what is the probability that in 3 days we'll be in state Y? So the quantity that keeps track of that is what we call the n-state transition probabilities. That's PnXY. So PnXY. And so the goal is to answer this question, is to compute this quantity. I remind you that it's typically difficult to answer this question if the state space is big or if N is large, okay? But if you deal with very small N and very small state space, typically it's possible to answer this question. So next typical question about a Markov chain. Again, I'm going to start with my two states here, X and Y. It's if we start from state X, what is the probability that we'll ever visit state Y? Okay, so I'm going to just draw an arrow like that with a question mark, meaning again, if we start from X, is it possible to go to state Y? And then this one is related to the notion of recurrence and transience of a state that's related to recurrence of state Y in this case. And so to answer this question, we want to compute this probability. So the probability starting from state X that we will ever visit state Y, that's exactly the event that the time of return to state Y is finite. And so that's going to be this less than infinity. So in the case of recurrence, this probability is 1. But now if your state is transient, that's strictly less than 1, it might be very difficult to actually give a very precise estimate of this probability in the case of transience. And so mostly the question is whether this probability is equal to 1 or not. So again, this second question is related to the notion of recurrence and transience. Now, third question, again, I'm going to start with those two states here. And now let's assume we are in the case where starting from state X, we know that we are going to eventually visit state Y. And in fact, we are going to go back to Y infinitely often. And now the question is about the fraction of time spent in state one in the long run. So this quantity is the limit when n goes to infinity of number of visits in state y before time n. So we define this quantity like that, divided by n. And we want to compute, if possible, compute explicitly this limit. That's third question. What is the fraction of time spent in a state? This is also related to what we call the mean recurrence time. That's the expected number of time steps you need starting from y to return to state y. Then finally, last question, the fourth and last question, it's about what we call the limiting probabilities. Now the question is slightly different from this one. It's if we start from state x, what is the probability that we will be in state y at some time n very large, okay? And so now what we want to compute in this case is instead the limit when n goes to infinity of pn x y. Okay, so again, can we compute this limit? So these are, I think, basically the four main questions you can have about a discrete-time Markov chain. There is maybe another one, which is about the mean recurrence time, but it's equivalent to this one. Answering this question also gives you an answer for the mean recurrence time. So we are going to use the diagram I showed you to see which path in the diagram we need to follow to answer this question. But before that, well, it turns out that not for all those questions, but for some of them, first we need to check some important ingredients about, you know, like to get some result about Markov chain. And those ingredients are irreducibility, positive recurrence, also the expression of the stationary distribution, if there is one, and finally, another important ingredient is aperiodicity. So now, before answering those questions, what I'm going to do is use this diagram to show you the steps you need to follow to check all those four ingredients. Again, irreducibility, positive recurrence, aperiodicity, and expression of the stationary distribution. And once we understand well how to check those four aspects, then I will go back to those four questions and we'll be able to see again how to use the diagram to answer those four questions. So first, how can we check whether the process is irreducible or not? And I'm precising in this slide that irreducibility is important because this is going to imply uniqueness of the stationary distribution if there is one. In this case, you are going to follow the path in white here in the picture. So first step is always to write the transition probabilities of the process. So I remind you that those transition probabilities are conditional probabilities. That's the probability of being in state y at some time, given that you are in state x at the previous time step. So that's also the probability of jumping from state x to state y in one time step. Then from that, you can construct the directed graph associated to the process. So the directed graph is obtained by drawing an arrow from state x to state y, if and only if the probability of going from x to y in one time step is strictly positive. And from this, you can easily deduce the communication classes of the process. So the way you can find the communication classes from the directed graph is, for instance, by looking at all the cycles, the directed cycles going, for instance, from x to x. And all the states you are going to visit along these cycles must be in the same communication class as x. And so from that, you can deduce easily the communication classes and whether the process is irreducible or not. And I remind you that irreducible means that there is only one communication class. So that's the first step you can do when you study a Markov chain, find whether the process is irreducible or not. So then Second step, we want to see whether the process is positive recurrent or not. So this question of positive recurrence is important because this is going to tell us something about existence of a stationary distribution. So in particular, if you combine irreducibility and positive recurrence, you have existence and uniqueness of the stationary distribution. So now, to see whether the process is positive recurrent or not, so let's assume that we were able to prove that the process is irreducible, and so following the same path as before. And now we have two possibilities. So case number one, the state space is finite. In this case, you have positive recurrence for free, so which will imply also existence of existence and uniqueness of the stationary distribution. But the difficult case is when the state space is infinite, in which case there is no way to tell easily whether the process is positive recurrent or not. And then to answer this question of positive recurrence, because in fact it turns out that positive recurrence does not just imply existence of a stationary distribution, that's in fact an equivalence. The process is positive recurrent if and only if there is at least one stationary distribution. Then to answer this question of positive recurrence in the infinite case, then what we need to do in fact is instead look at whether there is a stationary distribution or not. So this brings us to the third question. What is the expression of the stationary distribution? Is there a stationary distribution, and what is the expression of the stationary distribution? Again, this question is important because this will allow us to eventually find the fraction of time spent in a state and also the limiting probabilities of the process. So for that, we are going to instead use the transition probabilities to construct the transition matrix of the process. And I remind you that the transition matrix is just the matrix of the transition probabilities. And then using the transition matrix P, you want to solve the system pi P equals pi. So pi is going to be a row vector. And if you find solutions to this system, then the solutions such that the sum of the coordinates is equal to one are going to be the stationary distribution of your process. So if you are able to find that, then this means existence of a stationary distribution in particular, and then this would imply positive recurrence, and that's useful in the case where the state space is infinite and it's not clear whether the process is positive recurrent or not. So this is how you compute the stationary distribution in general, solving the system pi p equals pi. However, you have sometimes some shortcuts, and sometimes those shortcuts are necessary because the system pi p equals pi can be very complicated to solve. So the first case is when the process is doubly stochastic. So I remind you that doubly stochastic means that not only the transition matrix, but also the transpose of the transition matrix is a stochastic matrix. So in this case, this means that the sum of the coefficients along each column add up to one. And so if this is the case, and if also the state space is finite, then you can easily get the stationary distribution. We saw that in this case, the uniform distribution on the state space should be a stationary distribution. So that's one possibility. So case of doubly stochasticity. Then you can also check another aspect. It's called time reversibility. So we say again that the process is time reversible, and that there exists a reversible distribution pi if pi x times p x y is equal to pi y p y x. And if you can, again, find a solution to this set of equations that we call the detailed balance equation, then you are going to get some reversible distribution. But we saw that any reversible distribution is also a stationary distribution. So that might be another way to get your stationary distribution. Okay, so then last important ingredient we might need to understand to answer the four questions I wrote on the board, that's aperiodicity. And so aperiodicity means that all the states of your Markov chain have period one. This is important because this is going to tell us whether the limiting probabilities exist or not. And so to answer this question, it's better again to look at the directed graph representing the discrete-time Markov chain. And I remind you that the period of state x, so this is the GCD of all n such that Pn xx is strictly positive. And from your directed graph, the way you can find the period is simply by looking at all the possible directed cycles going from x to x. Then you look at the length of all those cycles. That's going to give you all the possible values of n such that Pn xx is strictly positive. And then from that, you just take the GCD, the greatest common divisor. I also remind you that the period is a class properly. And in particular, this means that if you you are dealing with an irreducible Markov chain, then to find the period of all the states, you only need to find the period of one state. And you know from the theory of Markov chain that all the other states will have the same period. So now let's go back to our four questions here. It turns out that the ingredients I just mentioned are useful mostly for the last two questions, also a little bit for this one, but this one can be determined regardless of whether the process is irreducible, aperiodic, positive or recurrent, and regardless of the expression of the stationary distribution. So let's look first at how can we compute those multi-step transition probabilities, Pn xy. So in the diagram now, what you want to do is follow this path going on the left. So first you write again the transition probabilities, that's always the first step. Now, in this case, to find the multi-step transition probabilities, or in general to compute for any kind of computational aspect about the Markov chain, what you want to do is write the transition matrix. And then to find the multi-step transition probabilities, you can just use this expression on the left. That's something that we proved using the Chapman-Kolmogorov equation. It's the fact that the probability of going from state x to state y in n time steps, so Pn xy, is in fact just equal to the coefficient xy of the matrix P raised at the power n. So this is the main technique to find those multi-step transition probabilities. So now let's look at the second question, whether a state or your process in general is recurrent or transient. So to answer this question, you are going to look at this middle part of the diagram in white here. So we already saw how to determine whether the process is positive recurrent or not. In case the process is positive recurrent, which happens if the state space is finite or if you were able to find a stationary distribution, in this case, there is nothing else to do because obviously positive recurrence implies recurrence. Now, the non-trivial case about recurrence and transience is when the state space is infinite and there is no stationary distribution. In this case, you know that the process can only be null recurrent or transient. And to decide whether the process is recurrent or transient, what you do is you find the multi-step transition probabilities. So at least a good enough estimate of the multi-step transition probabilities Pnxy. And then you are going to look at the infinite sum over n of the Pn xx. If this infinite sum is infinite, then your process is going to be recurrent. If at the opposite, this infinite sum is finite, then your process is transient. So now let's look at this first question about the fraction of time spent in a state. And I also remind you that this notion is related also to the mean recurrence time at this state. So to answer this question, again, you are going to look at the white part of the graph here. So let's assume that you are able to prove that the process is irreducible, and also you are able to check whether the process is positive recurrent or not. And again, if it's positive recurrent, then there must be a unique stationary distribution, and let's assume that you already know the stationary distribution. So these are three of the main ingredients I described earlier. And so starting from that knowledge, then you have two possibilities. First, that's on the left part of the directed graph here. Either there is no stationary distribution, so you are in the case of null recurrence or transient. Then in this case, you can say that the fraction of time spent in a state is going to converge to zero in the long run. At the opposite, if the process is positive recurrent, and so there is a unique stationary distribution, in this case, you know that a fraction of time spent in a state y is exactly going to be equal to the y-th coordinate of your stationary distribution pi. And you know also that this quantity is strictly positive. And then from that, you can also deduce the mean recurrence time at state y, so that again, the expected number of steps you need to go from state y back to state y, and this one is going to be equal to 1 divided by pi y. So finally, let's look at the fourth and last question about the limit of those multi-step transition probabilities that we call limiting probabilities of the process. So in this case, let's assume that we already were able to answer the previous question, question 3, about the fraction of time spent in a state. Then we have those two cases, so the case of null recurrence or transience, in which case fraction of time spent in a state goes to zero. Then in this case, you can also conclude that the limiting probabilities exist and they are going to go to zero, so meaning that PnXy converges to zero as n goes to infinity. At the opposite, if you are in the positive recurrent case, then again, you know existence and uniqueness of stationary distribution. You know that your fraction of time spent in a state is going to converge to the corresponding coefficient for the stationary distribution pi. And in this case, to get also convergence of the limiting probabilities, you need one more ingredient called aperiodicity. And so here to conclude, what you need to do first is, like I explained at the beginning of the video, look at the directed graph representation of your process to deduce the period of the states. And in case the process is aperiodic, meaning that the period is one, all the states have period one, in this case, you can conclude something slightly stronger than just convergence of the fraction of time spent in a state. You can also conclude that those limiting probabilities exist, and the limit is going to be again the same. So namely, PnXy is going to converge to pi y. However, be careful that if the period is not equal to one, then you don't have convergence of those limiting probabilities.